We're very excited to have all of you guys here today. Thank you for coming out to the 2018 Silicon Valley Tech Youth Day. We have Shivam, the founder, who just graduated a few days ago from high school, and he is an entrepreneur and aspiring programmer. Shivam founded the Silicon Valley Coders Club to create educational and economic opportunities for students, such as yourself, regardless of their socioeconomic status, for running a program that teaches the art of entrepreneurship. This program has been launched in 14 cities in California and a location in Charlotte, North Carolina, with over 2,000 students trained since the launch in June 2015, and over 100 startup projects have been launched and prototypes have been built. Shivam has developed two apps that are currently available in the Apple App Store. He developed a Saratoga Chamber of Commerce app as part of his Eagle Scout project that has had over 2,000 downloads. Shivam starts computer science at University of Washington, UW, in September, and will be interning at a startup, IoTUM. Let's introduce Shivam up on the stage. Give him a round of applause.
Thank you, Pooja, for introducing me. So yeah, hi, my name is Shivam Kumar. I founded this club back in June of 2015, right after the summer of my freshman year in high school. And I initially started this mainly to give, I was a rookie programmer back then. I just got into computer science. And I wanted to explore programming and bring this to other kids, my friends, middle schoolers, family friends, anything, to see what I can do to learn more about computer science with friends, my peers. So we began this as more of a computer science coding focus, but transitioned more to an entrepreneurship focus towards my sophomore year, 1 year later, and had our second annual Tech Day, which is about Pitch Fest, which we'll learn more about today. So mainly the Tech Day was started to teach all these kids, give them the experience of coming up, pitching their ideas, learning what it takes to make a business plan, how to present in front of other people, and mainly the key components of entrepreneurship and how they can use this in high school and in college and leadership skills they develop to do this. So every year today, there'll be two panels, the youth panel and the industry executive panel. There's a lot to learn, especially for the kids, about how the youth panel is seeing how they just graduated high school or college and are able to put their learning into perspective in the industry already. So I'll get started by introducing the youth panel. So first we have Tulsi Doshi. She's a product manager leading YouTube's effort in inclusive machine learning, building seamless, intuitive, and most importantly, fair, ethical interactions between humans and artificial intelligence. She's been at Google since April 2015 and has a bachelor's degree from Stanford in symbolic systems and a master's degree at Stanford in computer science. She won the Best Paper Award for paper submitted to the 27th Annual User Interface Software and Technology Symposium. So let's welcome her to the stage. We also have Paige Gunavelli. He's currently working at PayPal and has a bachelor's degree in applied math and computer science. He's currently working at PayPal on the core data platform team, working on its data migration and replication product. He has also worked on other PayPal initiatives, such as bill splitting feature, many of you may know Venmo, and leading PayPal's first blockchain initiative. He's also the founder of Touch a Life Foundation that wants to help homeless students in Silicon Valley actually involved in this effort. He's currently developing an application that will connect donors with the needy. So let's welcome him to the stage. Next, we have Abhi Singh. He's a machine learning engineer at NerdWallet who joined the company after graduating from UC Berkeley. He currently works on the core financial product recommendation engine, which is used by various teams intending to provide users with financial clarity for all life's financial decisions. When he isn't working, he's playing softball, cookies and trivia, and hikes on any trails he can find. So let's welcome Abhi to the stage. Last but not least, we have Harsha Mohan. He is a spacecraft configuration design intern at SSL, working towards a bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering from Texas A&M. He mainly is interested in mechanical design and development of electromechanical systems and business development for the next generation of spacecraft, automobiles, and consumer products. He has interned at NIO, an auto company of Silicon Valley. He is currently improving his programming skills in Python to complete to complement his design skills. So let's welcome Harsha to the stage. So my first question for all of you guys will be, what motivated you to pick where you want to go to school and the major you picked?
I guess I'll go first, Mike. Hi everyone, I'm Gulchi, and in terms of where I went to school and what I wanted to study, so I went to Stanford, which was actually a relatively easy choice for me given that I'm from Portland, Oregon, so like many of you who grew up on the West Coast, wanted to go to school on the West Coast. Stanford is a beautiful school, so it was a fairly easy choice that way. In terms of what I wanted to study, when I actually went to college, I actually really didn't know what I wanted to study. I didn't have a lot of computer science experience. I hadn't done a lot of STEM or tech work. I had taken some classes in high school, but not really done much more than that. Didn't have any app building experience or any of the great experience that you guys have gotten by doing this work. And so a lot of what I did actually was just start taking a bunch of classes that seemed really interesting. Took a few introductory computer science classes, took a psychology class, took a philosophy class, and started to try and figure out what are the actual problems that I'm interested in, what are the kinds of things that I want to work on. It's great too, I think, because once you get to college, you get a lot of chance to get mentorship, to talk to a lot of people who are really smart, who've done amazing things, talk to professors who have a lot of different experience, different walks of life. So I ended up majoring in what Stanford calls symbolic systems, and that's a degree of computer science, psychology, philosophy, and linguistics. And so you get to do a little bit of computer science, which is awesome, and that was actually the foundation of my degree. But you also get to do a lot of other classes that allow you to write, and then allow you to think more about how people think about technology and why they want to use technology. So yeah, I really enjoyed it.
Hey guys, I'm Harsha. I was born and raised in Saratoga. And well, I'm around from the area. When I was a senior in high school and I applied to colleges, it never really dawned upon me that when you choose a college, you have to go and live there for 4 years. And so I was more obsessed with the rankings and what other people thought of me when I was choosing my school. And so I got into an assortment of colleges. I didn't do the best in high school, not to the expectation that I wanted to. So I got into Texas A&M among other schools. And I knew that I wanted to do engineering when I went into college. So I chose Texas A&M because they have a fairly high public score ranking for engineering. When I got to Texas A&M, they missed the general engineering program. So you might put like aerospace and mechanical engineering for your computer science as your major. But everybody gets into general engineering. So you take the first year of classes, and then at the end of your freshman year, you apply to this thing called entry to major. And so I put mechanical engineering as my first choice and I got in. It was honestly arbitrary as to why I chose mechanical engineering. But looking back, it was a good choice. I found a lot of, so far in my internship experience, I've seeked out responsibility and challenges. And it's been really rewarding up until now, being able to work on next generation stuff. It's just being around people who are thinking about driving change in the world. It's really nice. So I think there's a lot of opportunity to take a really depressing job in engineering, but there's also a lot of opportunity to do something really awesome. And I've only really been in the professional environment for about 4 months now. It's been really awesome. So my advice to young kids is don't think so much about what other people do with the major that you're in. Think about what you can do with the major that you're in. Because there's always a way to combine your interests with the things that you're doing currently. And ultimately, if you don't do what you want to do, it's always better to be in your 40s. In my opinion, it's always better to be 40 years old and thinking, damn, I should have listened to my parents, versus being 40 years old and thinking, damn, I shouldn't have listened to my parents. So follow your heart and do what you really want to do. You might be in a major that the classes might suck at the time, but if you continue to push yourself towards the place that you want to be, I'm starting to see the fruits of my labor, and I didn't think I'd get to this point, and I'm only 20 years old. So it'll work out for you guys if you have that mission and drive and continue to do the things every single day to take you to the place that you want to be eventually.
Hi, everyone. My name is Javi. For me, my path actually very similar. I actually didn't know entirely what I wanted to study when I was going to college. The decision ended up being that I wanted to study engineering. I actually came into UC Berkeley in my engineering department. I'd actually never written a single line of code until I actually started doing research in my freshman year, where I was basically forced to do a lot of statistical analysis, and that's what I started to study in my lab. And at that moment, it was just, I fell in love with the community, especially numerical computing, and I started taking more classes in CS. So I'm kind of doing the same thing, but now instead of biology data sets, it's finance. The numerical methods are all the same. That was the process for me.
Hi everyone, I'm Tej. In terms of why I picked Berkeley, it was kind of just like the ideal location I grew up over here, so it was close enough to home, but also far enough away where I could kind of just like be on my own. And in terms of why I picked the majors, I actually remember back towards the end of high school saying, like, oh, I don't want to do computer science because I didn't want to live up to a stereotype. But my parents were like, you know what, just take a class. And then, you know, we'll see what you think after that, right? And I just fell in love with it. It was a perfect chance for me to, you know, embrace problem solving skills, for me to, like, try creative things. There was such an embracing and warm community behind just, you know, trying to be different or trying to do something new, and everyone was there to like either cheer you on or work with you, and that's like, in my opinion, one of the best parts about being in tech.
So thanks. I know you guys touched on it a little bit about like what these kids can do when they're in high school or college. And we do have a lot of middle schoolers and high schoolers in the audience. So my next question would be, what are two or three things you guys would say that could lead to success in high school or college?
First of all, I think Harsha really touched on this, is really do the things and invest in the things that you love to do. I'm a dancer, and I spent a lot of my time in high school and college actually focusing on dance. I joined a Ross team, which I don't know if you know what that is, but it's folk dance. We competed nationally, and we traveled around the country, and it was a great way to like meet people, to form a really close set of friends, to actually get engaged in community, to do the things that I loved. And to be honest, as much as I think that doesn't sound like academic advice or career advice, it gives you a chance to explore leadership, to explore passion, to explore thinking about things that you care about, which is also something that applies to when you start writing your college essay, interviewing for a job. They want to know that you care about something and that you're passionate about something. And those things translate into everything else that you do after that. From a career perspective, I think trying as many things as you can right now to start figuring out what kinds of things you like, right? That might be technology and trying to do projects that you're excited about. That could also be writing and trying to articulate your ideas in an interesting way. That could be going to really cool events and listening to a lot of really cool lectures and talks. I think right now you have this time and this chance to just like learn about as many things as you can and find really cool opportunities. And that's gonna help you start figuring out what is it actually that I like doing? What is it that I wanna do? And when I go to college and I need to actually focus in a little bit more and like take some of those very specific classes, what are the kinds of classes that I actually wanna take? I would say too though that you have time. You have a lot of time. and I think there's no reason to worry. I mean, I didn't know, and I think many people here said, like, we didn't really know what we wanted to do when we went to college. And so there's no rush, there's no urgency there. And so you have time to really just focus on things that you care about.
For me, I found that there were kind of two big things. One, I noticed a lot of people up here were talking about community. The really cool thing about computer science is software is essentially just people expressing opinions through different languages, frameworks, so on and so forth. And so there are communities of people who agree or disagree with those opinions. If you disagree, you create your own opinion. But you have this like beautiful open source community and just everywhere. And so it's really interesting to like find your tribe and start either becoming fanatically obsessed with that idea, just seeing where you go, like basically follow the road, explore things, study as much as you can among things that you find interesting. But also you want to make sure you're not just going down one road, you also want to explore as well. Did I think that I would be doing recommending financial products when I came to Berkeley? No, but here I am. And so these things are pretty interesting, but I think the second really big one for me is putting yourself in a position to be set up for learning and growing. And that's kind of like a state, for me, it's kind of like a state of mind. It's just asking the right questions, figuring out, like always putting myself in the position of an underdog where I have no idea. I'm just jumping out of my comfort zone. I have no idea what I'm doing, but I'll do it anyway, we'll figure it out. And I find that even if it's like softball, which I picked up last year, I've never played baseball or cricket or anything before, but now I'm playing first base every weekend. It's pretty fun. And so like these, all small things like this, teach you how to ask good questions, figure out how to actually like learn a ton, and then you can take it in from whether it's softball to trivia to software engineering or learning math.
Just to reemphasize like the whole like, community thing that was mentioned earlier, I mean, you're not really on this like, journey alone if you think about it, right? There's a lot of people who are there to help you out, to work with. Make friends, that's the number one thing, I'd say, because those friends are there for you to work with. You saw it in the back earlier, all of your projects, that was you working with your friends to come up and make something very interesting. And when I look back, all of the interesting projects that I did, all the cool things that I did, that was because I worked with people who, you know, had an interesting idea or who inspired me to, you know, pursue an interesting idea. And the only way you're going to be able to do that is if you, you know, find the right group of people and, you know, constantly challenge each other and, you know, constantly try new things with each other.
So I think one of the advantages of being young is that a lot of adults want to talk to you because they miss being young as well. That's one thing that I've been really leveraging to my success lately. When I was about 18 years old, I discovered that if you just go up to somebody and talk to them, more often than not, they'll usually talk to you back, regardless of their status or whatever in society. A little example of this, when I was working at NIO, the electric autonomous vehicle company last summer, I saw the CEO of Mercedes-Benz R&D North America in the office during lunch, and most kids who are 18 or 19 years old working an internship would be really intimidated to go up and talk to the CEO of Mercedes-Benz North America. But I went up to him and talked to him, and I talked to him for about 20 minutes, and he connected with me on LinkedIn. And so I think that that one moment really like epitomized, like, wow. You know, this guy's a CEO now, but at some point he was 19 years old and he was also an intern. And he saw that I had the confidence to go and talk to him. And he's now my first connection on LinkedIn. And I tried to reach out to him for help. He didn't reply, but nonetheless, it's still a good story to talk about and kind of like boost my ego. But I think, especially you, Logan, I noticed that you have a really good ability to talk and express yourself. So I think kids like you should really leverage that, because soft skills are really important, regardless of your talent, because the Silicon Valley is loaded with talent. All these kids out here, you guys have it really good. You have parents who support you to really help you reach the highest level you can possibly attain and really actualize yourself. So I think if you guys develop your soft skills and seek out people, especially adults now, like your parents, friends, and whatnot, if they live here, they've gotten to a level where they can afford to live here, which usually means that they've worked pretty hard and like they've established themselves. So take advantage of that, because I know that from living in College Station, Texas and Texas A&M, this is a privilege that only we get. And so take advantage of it while you still live at home.
So a lot of the kids here are really interested in entrepreneurship, of course, they have their projects. And you guys are all involved in engineering and computer science. There's so much you can do with almost like any idea that you get. So I want to know, what are some entrepreneur initiatives that you guys started, whether it's in college or after college?
So I participated in a program called startup. They run around different universities across the nation. And at this event, I partnered up with four other people to make a platform, an educational technology platform that we're currently working on right now. But basically, the idea behind the platform is to provide a medium for teachers to collaborate on it's a platform for teachers to collaborate and develop their curriculum materials. Because at the end of the year, when the teaching standards get updated, the learning objectives get updated, teachers have to rework and retool their curriculums. And so we're developing a website or a platform where teachers can develop their platforms and also there's also a side of that platform for the students who they can log on and they can do their tasks. So we're trying to make a centralized platform where it's like a professional social media where teachers can build upon their ideas and gain access to insights and communicate with teachers who are in other areas of the world and who have totally different teaching styles and methods.
So for me, a big part was when I joined NerdWallet a bit initially, I used to start working on a lot of A/B testing problems. NerdWallet, when I joined, was a 90-person company. We now have hit 500. And so at the time, a lot of infrastructure, a lot of data pipelines that we now use to make a bunch of business decisions were not built yet. And so I was tasked with building a lot of those. When you are there in the onset, you get to really rethink and think about, okay, what are people doing in larger corporations when they're building these things, and building out these processes, analyzing these results, and building out these platforms? And what can we do better? What is something that we're in a unique position to learn faster, move quicker, build and deploy and release different systems at even quicker speeds? And so we started to realize that. And so as a result, me and some friends started hacking together different A/B testing analyses using Bayesian methods versus frequent test methods, which is currently what's being done in like platforms like Optimizely or like Amplitude and whatnot. And so right now we have kind of the ideas, all the math's been figured out, which was the hard part. Now we're actually working on like the systems, which is a lot easier and a lot more ubiquitous because everybody's kind of doing the same thing on the build release side of things. Now it's just a question of creating an interface where it's really easy to pull for a PM or an engineer to deploy a tool, know exactly if X variant is performing better, so that they can actually ship features faster and more quicker, especially in a chaotic marketplace like the internet.
For myself at least, for the last few years, I've been running a nonprofit organization that I started called the Touch of Life Foundation. Our entire motto has been, helping homeless students within the Bay Area, which I think we all know that there are like homeless high school students or homeless individuals in this area, but it's something that we often forget, especially because we live within such possibly one of the richest areas in the United States. So our goal has always been, how do we deliver backpacks, how do we deliver socks, how do we deliver sweaters, the basic necessities that high school students would need, but you don't normally have to like think about those. And we held a fundraiser last December, and now we're starting to build this sort of software platform where homeless liaisons and social workers can reach out and say, here's what my local homeless students in my area need, and we'll be able to reach out to other individuals and donors and say, look, this is what people need, can you please provide for them? And so that's from an entrepreneurial perspective, I guess. It doesn't always have to be a business side of things. It can also be for social good.
I think to echo that last point, I think really when it comes down to entrepreneurship and wanting to start something, it really comes down to where do you see a need, right? Where do you see something where you think, hey, I could do something about that and I could make a difference? And that could be in the form of an app or a software project. That could be in the form of a nonprofit. That could be in the form of an initiative or a team. Most recently, I work at Google, which is not a startup, to say the least. But I've actually been starting a new team at Google, which is about five people now, where we're actually focusing specifically on what we're calling fairness in machine learning. And that's thinking about specifically when you are actually building machine learning systems, how do you build them so that they work well for everybody? So whether you're in the United States or you're in a different country or you're a boy or a girl, can we make sure that machine learning and the products that we're building work well for everybody? And so that's actually a kind of interesting example of even in a big space, even like a really big company where there's a lot of people doing a lot of stuff, if you find something that you care about that you think is really important to you, you can actually be an entrepreneur and you can make that happen. And you can work on creating the efforts and work talking with people, like Harsha said, reaching out to anybody who was willing to talk to you and get an idea off the ground. And so now I'm leading a small team of like 5 or 6 people in this effort.
Yeah, it's really important. I stressed it how there's so many ways that you can make a difference with anything. You guys have all been working on these projects this past semester, so it's really good to pursue that creativity that you guys all have. So my final question would be, do you guys have any final words to give to the kids here that would inspire them to pursue a tech major or a tech career?
Final words of wisdom.
Honestly, I think me going to tech is a genetic predisposition. I don't know. I discovered that my dad also did mechanical engineering after I got into mechanical engineering. So I don't know. I think follow whatever your heart says, because I mean that's so cliche. Wow. But just like you're only young once. And like I'm still young, but if you're only really young once, and you can really do whatever you want. Like there's so many forks of the road at this stage in your life, so take advantage of that. Gain exposure anywhere you can get, because it'll all be valuable in the end.
So I think the really cool thing about tech right now is that technology is growing so quickly and so fast that if you learn a lot of these basic technology skills, they're probably going to be useful in any life problem, right? We saw projects back there that are looking at health and how technology can help issues in medicine, right? Technology can help issues in like public service, whether that be trash cans or something else. And so I think the really cool thing about technology today is like you can actually do anything once you start learning basic technology skills. And so I think the main advice I would say, the thing I would remember is like, while you have the chance, and especially as you're thinking about what you want to study, try to study something that's not technology, even while you're studying technology. Whether that's something like bio and bioengineering, or whether that's social sciences, or whether that's thinking about public policy. Because I think where it's really cool is that if you're excited about something and you're passionate about something, even if it's like dance, right? I think technology can actually really change the way that people are thinking about these domains and the way that people are interacting with the world. And so you can actually bridge gaps. Not everybody has the ability to do that. So definitely study what you're passionate about. Technology will always be useful in doing that. So having some basic skills, it's kind of like writing, right? It's good to be able to know how to do it. But that doesn't have to be the only thing that you do. And it doesn't have to mean that if you care about something else, you're passionate about something else, that you can't have a career in tech.
Inspiring everyone's pretty tough. So the way I see things is there's a nerdy CS joke that our 61A professor used to always make, which was everything is a graph if you think hard enough. And I think there's an element to truth about it, which is like no matter what field you're in, whether it's like I've seen recruiters using technology, there's in biology, finance, really CS or essential CS education is kind of a need everywhere. But that's awesome because technology is essentially like an amplifier, right? It amplifies good things, it also amplifies bad things. And so regardless, there is a need, and I'm really happy that there are at least a bunch of people in the younger generations who are going to be there to solve those really, really hard problems. I think another big one is just, I think this was touched on earlier, but really seriously, be passionate. Find something that you really, really, really care about. Find and you can explore it. It'll take you a while to find that one thing, but when you find it, it's awesome. You can start reading about it, talking to other people, engaging in different communities. Really start having a blast. And I would definitely recommend anyone that if you are passionate and you are interested at all in like being analytical and whatnot, computer science, or at least STEM fields are amazing. It would definitely be a great place to get started.
I think it's important for everyone to remember that tech isn't the final product. It's just the tools and the means that it takes to get there, right? So always have a diverse array of interests to be able to channel that into technology. But something that's unique to probably your time now is I definitely didn't do any of that in middle school, right? Like in terms of like all the cool technology stuff that you guys are doing using, like I saw like someone using like dial-up flow. There's so many things available for you guys to do today as like high schoolers or middle schoolers. You know, you have the opportunity to just like take that baton and just go with it. The barrier to entry is so much, you know, lower now. So definitely just, rather than, you know, thinking, you know, will I like this, will I not like this, just go for it, just try it, and, you know, after that you can decide, but that, once you get, try it, I'm 100% certain you'll get hooked.
I have one more last word of advice. I've yet to meet an entrepreneur who doesn't always carry a notebook with them, and if you don't carry a notebook with you, they always have a pen on them, so always carry a notebook with you. Don't have that, keep the pen on you at least in your pocket. It'll always be useful.
I hope all the young kids here at least got one thing, one piece of advice that they can use. So let's give a big round of applause for our audience.
Ethernet switching, system architectures, networking protocols, and management. Mohan has a PhD in operations research from the Ohio State University. Welcome, Mohan. And last but not least, we have Rishi Kumar. Rishi's professional experience is a nexus of high-tech, public, private, nonprofit policymaking in the world of politics. Rishi is a high-tech Silicon Valley executive and a public servant, serving the city of Saratoga as a council member. Councilmember Rishi Kumar of Saratoga seeks to apply the high-tech framework to city government and offer services that are cheaper, faster, and better for his community. Rishi works full-time in Silicon Valley high-tech, and he is vice president of strategic business at Solus Technologies, a software company that offers big data, analytics solutions to various industry verticals. He is a former IBMer. Rishi's success in Silicon Valley stems not only from his love for cutting-edge technology, business, sales, technology, leadership, but also from his ability to network, develop relationships with industry, political leaders, and advocacy groups, and formulating successful partnerships. Let's welcome Rishi to the stage.
And to be a fabulous MC, I think we need to give it up for Pooja. Yes, we forgot one thing, so we would like to invite Tulsi Dev Doshi back on stage, please. And we have a little appreciation for you for joining us today. I think the youth panel did a fabulous job, didn't they? Abhi Singh and Nerd Wallet. PayPal. So we had a pretty animated discussion going with this group panel. Finally, Harsha. Harsha did not know he was on the panel until he showed up here. and Harsha kept rubbing it in, hey, we are the young people here, but I think we are equally young here, right? At least the young at heart. Yes, at least in mind. But you know, it's a fabulous panel. And typically we used to run this Women in Tech panel and a separate industry executive panel. But we said, let's do a convergence because you know, it's a lot easier to just have a dialogue, bring in a few different sets of background and talk a little bit. But this really is about innovation because when you look at the Silicon Valley Coders Club, you know, they have launched so many different startups and in so many different locations. In fact, one of the slides we were actually looking through, almost like 14, 15 locations in California, including 4 locations in San Jose. So, and also a location in Charlotte, North Carolina. And this is a free program, there's no charge, and these kids show up there, and they learn the art of startup. And it's been a pretty fabulous experience to figure out, you know, how these raw young minds are innovating. So my first question is really about innovation. So let me do a little analogy here. When it comes to innovation, and then the paradigm shift of what it takes to innovate. So let's look at Sun Microsystems. And you know, Sun Microsystems is actually housed in a building that is currently occupied by Facebook. And so what Mark has done, Mark Zuckerberg, you know, he got the Facebook big sign as you enter the campus. But if anybody's gone to the back of the sign, back of the Facebook big sign as you enter the campus, it's got the Sun Microsystem logo still there, which is a reminder that, you know, you can innovate, but when you don't have a product, when you're not able to sell, when you cannot market, then the product is going to likely die down. And that's really what happened to Sun, because they were amazing innovators. So what we said was, as a framework of that innovation story, we need to provide them the tips and hints of how do you price a product, how do you market a product. So later on today, we'll actually see some of these teams that we present. So if you stay on, you will be wow with the kind of projects that will be presented. So let's talk a little bit about innovation. And I would love to get a perspective from the panel in terms of, you know, what exactly is your perspective of innovation and what is that secret sauce that helps a startup succeed or that has helped you succeed over the years. You know, we'll start with Mohan.
Innovation for the sake of innovation, I don't know where that will really go. But I think, first of all, you have to look at the need, you know, what is the problem you're trying to address? What are the solutions? Now, when you come up with some cool idea, let's say you come up with a great
innovative idea to address that problem. You have to think in terms of how will this be successful? So in order for anything to be adopted, it has to be, you know, it has to have the right attributes in terms of cost. It has to be appealing, it has to be friendly. So it's one thing to innovate, but then if you want that innovation to be taken forward, you have to make sure that it has that common mass appeal.
So I would like to suggest that the most important thing is to truly understand in depth the customer pain. You have to have a great understanding of the environment and the pain that the customer feels. It can't be a nice to have, it can't be something that might be good to have. It has to be a real pain. And your innovation has to solve that pain. Then once you have that, you have to attract a fantastic team to work with you. And you have to understand how you do that. What kind of skills do you need to complement your own so that you can build a full team to go after that?
Great, so I would definitely echo that customer. I was thinking about the best gig when I look back on my career that I ever had was what they talked about in smart care. So we were trying to reinvent one of the crustiest, oldest things on the planet, which was technical support, which sounds boring, but when you take, you know, the customer, and in this case, we were developing it for the partners that serve our customers, when you use that as your North Star, and when you realize what's preventing them at the end to have a great experience, and what's preventing those that you ask to help them, you can really begin to think differently, and really challenge the way that you do it, right? You really have to get a great group of people that believe in this mission. Right? It can't just be a job. And I was amazed every day when I had the honor to lead a whole cross-functional team that did amazing things because they believed in the mission we were on. And we really invented a new genre of what is now called smart services at Cisco. And you're going to look back on these times in your life where you get to work on a great gig like that, and you're going to say, wow, that was really special, so I'm very fortunate to experience that. And again, the North Star is always the customer.
Innovation, that's a hot word in Silicon Valley and in general all over the world these days. Innovation is new ideas, new way of doing things, faster, cheaper, and more efficient. And these days, I think, you know, we are in a very interesting times where innovation is disrupting the way, you know, we are conducting our everyday life, the way companies function, and the way the world is moving, right? So in that context, innovation has caught a lot of attention from all the companies around the world. In fact, you know, recently, you see, when you drive down 101, go to, you know, different areas of Mountain View, Palo Alto, San Francisco, San Jose, you see companies from all over the, you know, world coming in and setting up innovation centers. Right? So, innovation centers, again, you know, are primarily meant to disrupt the way things are currently functioning. And a good example of that is what Tesla has done for cars. You know, they've, you know, disrupted, you know, the industry where you take a traditional, you know, gas automobile to, you know, taking it into a whole new world. Like that, you've seen Uber disrupting, you know, an entire industry of taxi cabs into a whole new generation. So it's a very interesting times, you know, that we are in right now, where disruptive innovation can be applied to everything that we do. And I think these young students that are gathered here, you know, are very creative, and you know, I applaud the Silicon Valley Youth Corps Club, Youth Corps Club, Shivam and Rishi and the team, you know, what they're doing here to promote innovation and, you know, bring the spirit of the creativity over here. I think all of you are going in a very good path of, you know, what innovation, you know, can be changing everyday life. And it's good to see all the, you know, team members over here on different tables, innovating in each different areas. So innovation is core in for a long time.
We need the mic right there, and, so we'll go on to the next question, but yes, yes, I think Mohan wants to answer. Yep, absolutely.
Just to add to what Meena was saying, right, so I was just thinking about Elon Musk, right, one of the greatest disruptors and innovators. Just reading a book about him. So apparently he made like $180 million in PayPal, and he took $100 million and invested in SpaceX, $70 million in Tesla, and $10 million in SolarCity. All of this is like, you know, he wants to build cool, innovative products that, you know, make, you know, life or much easier for people out there.
That's a great point, because when I look at what Sherry said earlier was the North Star is the customer. You follow the North Star, and when you look at Elon Musk, he's created some pretty compelling products that are being adopted by their customers so readily. I mean, look at how Tesla has thrived as a company and done so well. I mean, the very first week when we had Tesla's release, we were watching all these cars going by, and it was like, wow, you know, what kind of car is this, right? So that's really what innovation is, because you are creating a huge shift in the industry by producing a product which is unlike anything that has been there before. But more than anything, you're solving challenges. You're solving challenges of the daily work, and you're making life better. So for example, you know, Tej was speaking earlier, and Tej has launched a nonprofit, and they are actually looking to solve problems of like homeless students here in Silicon Valley. And that also is innovation, because you can apply to pretty much anything in the world of nonprofit, the world of education, the world of the public sector. There is tremendous opportunity. But you know, when you look at innovation, so going to Veena, you know, I was reading of Veena's profile, and it looked like there is a lot of fair bit of innovation that Veena has launched in her company, Imagia. And there is a product called Gia, which is basically a chatbot or a virtual assistant that has been launched. And I'm kind of curious, you know, what led, because, you know, at the end of the day, it's all about the data. So the data that Imagia's customers are harnessing is around the world of finance. But what, Veena, what led you down this path of coming up with this fairly innovative framework of providing CFOs and the world of finance easy access to information? Let's, would love to hear about it.
So we recently launched a product called Gia. Gia is you know, a virtual finance assistant for enterprise finance executives like CFOs, controllers, treasurers, and other executives and staff within the finance organization. A good analogy to that is Siri, what you have on your phone, and or Google Assistant. You ask questions about your daily, daily activities, you know, to Siri, for example, you know, or Google Maps, or, you know, others. Hey, I want to go to, you know, San Jose. You know, give me the direction. Or, you know, hey, what's the weather like today? And, you know, or, you know, give me, you know, flight schedule for, you know, American Airlines, so and so this afternoon. So you can ask questions, and you're already getting those answers, you know, from Siri and Google Assistant and all of that. But think about within the businesses, you know, when you're running large corporations, you know, finance executives, you know, do not have the visibility or a timely visibility on what's happening on, you know, my, you know, let's say a division out in Switzerland, you know, what's the daily sales, you know, how does it look like, how is the billing, does it look like, how much cash do you receive over there, and are you losing money, gaining money, etc. So today, you know, in the enterprises, it's a very complex, you know, way of you know, gathering information, the way information is organized all around the world. So we have trained what we call as, you know, this digital finance assistant with skills that are equivalent to, you know, a finance person. that can be, you know, sitting right beside you, and you can ask questions, and they may be accessing multiple systems, gathering information, processing that information. So GDAL today processes, you know, any information in the enterprise and can give quick answers, you know, to CFOs just as an assistant, you know, what an assistant would do. Not only that, you know, GDAL can perform activities, you know, go get a, you know, financial statement of so-and-so company, or, you know, send an email to so-and-so, or, you know, configure this, you know, process a sales order, you know, things like that, right? So now the idea behind that is, you know, why did we do this innovation, and, you know, what is in it, and why do people care about it, right? Again, I go back to the principle of doing things differently, not for the sake of just doing it for the sake of doing it differently, but for doing something cheaper, faster, efficient, right? And that's, you know, how do you derive value of any innovation? You know, the ability to make things do cheaper, faster, efficient, and more strategic in this particular case, right? So think about, you know, having something like a digital, you know, digital assistant or digital labor. You know, today everyone is worried about, hey, you know, I want to reduce the cost, I want to automate everything. I'm sending, especially in the finance world, you know, sending outsourcing, offshoring to all over the place. In this particular case, you know, it's a digital assistant where the assistant itself can perform a lot of activities and can save a lot of costs, as well as, you know, it can give a lot of strategic information to make very timely decisions. So it's, again, you know, adding like another human being into the finance department. So the value of that is, I think, you know, tremendous for organizations, and today it's being very well received. You know, we are actually one of the top 10 fintech companies to, you know, watch out for, you know, in 2018, listed by CFO Magazine, and we've also received multiple awards on this particular one. So my message, you know, on innovation is look to the future. You know, how are things going to change 5 years from now, 10 years from now, and how do you steer yourself towards that particular direction? So almost like a being, you know, a trailblazer, being creative. Almost like a fiction, you know, you enjoy, you know, what can be, you know, unrealistic or unimaginable, and try to attempt to bring that today and grow that particular idea, because eventually it will be the reality in the future. So young entrepreneurs and, you know, young, you know, tech engineers, focus on what can potentially happen 10 years from now, 5 years from now, and bring that into the system. So that's from an innovation message perspective, you know, absolutely encourage that, and that's what we did with GI.
So what I'm hearing, you know, innovation is about solving problems, right? And that's what we are hearing, following what the customer wants. But when you look at, the world is also changing, and that's a huge opportunity for us, for each of us, you know, for every one of us to go out there and do something better than what we have done in the past. And for example, you know, you look at Siri, or you look at Alexa, or you look at Gia, you know, they are basically creating a paradigm shift in the industry. I was an early adopter of Alexa, and, you know, I saw something on Amazon, I ordered it, and I didn't know what I was signing up for, and it shows up at my home, and it's like a little cylinder that pops in. And so as I started trying to figure out what this product was, you had about 10, 15 apps they had back then. And now you have like thousands of apps. I mean, there are folks who are making a living by just building an app that they have rolled out on Alexa. So that's the future, you know. Look at my phone. You know, sometimes I try to figure out what application was that. And I was trying to scan a wine bottle last night and trying to figure out, and I just couldn't figure out which application I'm going to use for that, right? What about a bot? A bot that could replace essentially all the applications that you're just talking and interacting to that bot on your cell phone, that would provide you every other backend application that you need for your daily existence, right? I mean, these are the kind of paradigm shift that you see in the world of technology. So let's talk to Sherry. And you know, Cisco SmartCare is a phenomenal story. I mean, leading it from essentially the ground up at $0, turning it into a $50 million, and then today it's $1 billion. So Sherry, we'd love to hear, you know, what were some of the key ingredients for success You know, what exactly happened during that journey? Love to hear.
Yeah, so as I said before, it was, you know, the most important piece. In fact, I almost refused to take the opportunity. I said, the only thing I will compromise on is we must keep the customer as our North Star. If we start to diverge away from that, because what happens, especially in a big company, is they're like, yeah, I know you want to go that way, but this is kind of how we do it. Can you sort of shift what it is so that you can make it more like we are? And I think that's a really dangerous place to go. That's sort of anti-innovation, right? You end up with something that, you know, looks like a, you know, looks like a little bit like a Frankenstein monster at the end. So I think the one piece is really to be resolute in your mission. And one of the things that was amazing to me is the team that did it stayed in their function, right? Like the IT guys stayed in IT and the ops guys stayed in ops. So my core team wasn't that large, but those people were so into the mission of what we were creating together that they would move heaven and earth, and they were actually more powerful because they stayed in their function. So this idea that, you know, you have a unified mission. You guys are all on the same page to solve a problem, be it social, economic, societal, something to do with the environment. And this idea that you really have to be clear and connected on your mission is key to being successful. And sticking with it, really. Like, and I would say to all of you, I remember when I was at engineering school, and I remember, you know, a friend to the left would drop out, a friend to the right would drop out, because it can get hard. Just like inventing can be hard, you know, pushing against the establishment can be hard. But I would really encourage you to stick with it. Nothing worth doing is going to be easy. And gosh, when you come out the other end and you've invented something or you've gotten your degree that will give you permission to be in a place that gives you the tools to invent, that's going to be really worth it. So stick with it, I would say. Stick with it. Be perseverant.
Yep, absolutely. That's key, you know, just to take up an idea, and this is what some of the startup teams, they're doing. They come up with an idea, they come up with 10 different ideas, but ultimately they have to pick one and then take it all the way to the finish line, and that's really what Sherry's message is. So let's talk to Dave, you know, genetic networks and genomes. You know, it sounds pretty sexy, Dave, but would love to find out, you know, how exactly you ended up on this and what problems are you going to solve for the world. Would love to hear.
All right, so I'm not sure if you all are aware, but if you get a disease and you go to the doctor and the doctor prescribes a medication to you, the chances are 30 to 50% that it will work for you. That's why there are 5 or 6 or 10 different medications on the market for each disease. At Genetic Networks, we are going to take the patient's genetic sequence and determine specifically which medication is best for each patient. Now, this technology is based upon a Nobel Prize that was won in the 1990s by Dr. Lee Hartwell. That is over 20 years ago. The team that has been working on this has been working on it nonstop for that 20 plus years. They believe in themselves and they have been persistent. So I would like to add to the point about being persistent that you have to believe in yourself. Nobody else is going to believe in you if you don't believe in yourself. So that's what the company is all about, and it's extraordinarily exciting. We're already working with 2 major pharmas, and it's about to launch big time.
That is really an exciting conversion. So the world of healthcare, you know, there is less IT happening in healthcare than what should be. And I can see this radically changing patient care and optimizing patient care the next few years. So I think it sounds like a phenomenal startup that will create a huge difference. So let's go to Mohan. And with Mohan, he's an expert on Ethernet switching. But you know, Ethernet switching is kind of like been there, done that, you know, it's kind of old stuff. So how do you see the evolution of this, Mohan? Where is this going? You know, what do you see the future?
Okay, so for those of you who don't know, computers, you know, how do you interconnect them? You interconnect them through switches, and predominantly these are Ethernet switches. So if you look at the likes of Google, Facebook, Amazon, they have huge data centers, right? Thousands and thousands, literally hundreds of thousands of servers. So these are the compute elements. They have lots of storage. And how do you interconnect them, right? So this is where the Ethernet switches come into play, the switches and routers. And so these data centers, networking, we call it networking, so Ethernet switch is part of that. Networking is very essential for these data centers. So with the advent of, you know, why did these data centers really take off? So if you see, right, I mean, the advent of the smartphone, right, more and more applications, video streaming and things like that. Now, all of this thing has to be streamed down to the phone, so that data has to reside somewhere that has to be accessible very easily, and it has to be fast. So no one server or computer can hold all of this data. So you have to have a network that can interconnect all of these things and provide that service, you know, very rapidly. So that's on the networking side. So what I'm involved in is the switches that go make that are part of these networks. And the challenge there is that, you know, with the rising bandwidth, right, lots of users, lots of applications, lots of bandwidth. So you need the compute element or the servers. Those bandwidths are going up. But then you have to have the interconnect bandwidth goes up. Then what that means is the underlying device, how do you make it such that can be built at a higher bandwidth, more power efficient, more cost efficient? So this is where all the innovation is going, like in terms of making it, because data centers, I don't know if you guys know it or not, they take up a lot of power. So that's why you find some of these companies, you know, building data centers in cold places, right, so that they don't have to, you know, so that the power, you know, the OPEX is, you know, you can reduce on the OPEX. So in terms of innovation, that's where we are headed in terms of trying to make these devices, you know, much smaller, more power efficient, and more affordable as well.
So, there is constant innovation happening is what we are hearing. You know, you look at the world of genetics and how Dave's company is looking to impact patient care. It's just phenomenal. But, you know, you are essentially getting a cross-section of what innovation is happening in Silicon Valley with the software industry, with the world of healthcare, with the networking industry, and all these types of companies were startups. Cisco was a startup like decades ago, and then it became one of the big giants in Silicon Valley. And when I look at, I spent many years in IBM, and in the early 90s was when IBM, I wasn't working for IBM then, but it was sort of like not doing quite well, and they had to turn things around. They had to turn things around and position all their products from a standpoint of what's really needed by my customer, and not working backwards, where you create a product and then try to figure out, you know, who your customer is. And that was a wrong algorithm. And essentially, after they shifted and they fixed that, you know, IBM became a much more successful company. So IBM is also innovating, and that's the reason why it has stuck around for more than 100 years now, right? But what about Silicon Valley? Because, you know, where we live, many of us, we live where there were fruit orchards. And some of you who were born and raised here in California might have stories to tell. And I do hear it from so many in our community of Saratoga, that where you guys live, it was all fruit orchards, plum trees, and look at what happened here, right? So Silicon Valley is now, we have a problem where we have a housing problem, we have a transportation problem, and apparently there are companies that are sort of moving out of Silicon Valley. And then, you know, how will that innovation play out over the next few years? And so I'm a little bit struggling with that. In fact, I've heard some elected leaders say that, no, we don't want any more startups in my city because I'm like done with that. And I don't believe that is right, because that is the foundation of our success, and this is really what defines Silicon Valley. But I would love to get a perspective from the panel in terms of where do we see this evolving? What's the secret sauce? And do you see, like, in 10, 20 years, Silicon Valley thriving and still alive and kicking? And what would be some of the key foundation elements of making sure it happens? We'll start with Mohan.
I think the key thing here is what I call as ecosystem. I have not seen anywhere else such a strong ecosystem. So what do I mean by that? We have, you know, lots of good companies like, you know, Google, Microsoft is here, although they are in Seattle, Facebook, Tesla. You have lots of companies. So lots of great companies here, and great companies attract top talent, right? So the talent comes from here. You also have great schools here, like, you know, Stanford and Berkeley. In fact, yesterday I was at Stanford retreat. It's an annual retreat they have with all their students. Many of these are all PhD students. Many of their students, they had a day and a half session where they would come and for the industry, we were members of this consortium there. They would come and present all the projects that they have done. And these were all like, you know, these are not like theoretical projects. These were like, you know, projects that were trying to address real problems. For example, there was one professor and their students, they were showing how, you know, they were working on a distributed control system for drones, right? Like if you see drones, you know, the just like a, you know, like an airplane formation, you have several planes flying in a formation. They had come up with an algorithm as to how to have, you know, these drones fly in formation kind of stuff. So that's what I mean. So it's like that ecosystem, that strong ecosystem, it continues to thrive, right? And we have lots of startups here. It's like a continuous cycle that seems to have, and I think that this is gonna continue for a long period of time. But yes, I do agree there are other social challenges in terms of housing and transportation and things like that. But I'm hoping that, you know, somebody will come up with solutions. Like, for instance, right in LA, you know, Elon Musk came up with the Boring Town, right? That's an example, or the Hyperloop transport. So I'm hoping that there will be entrepreneurs that will come up with solutions to address those kinds of problems as well.
In my, what I do for a living these days is I work as a consultant with multiple different startups, and new startups come to me all the time and ask me if I will work with them. And they come from all over the United States. The first thing that I ask them is, why are you located where you are, and will you consider moving to Silicon Valley? And the reason that I ask them, will they consider moving to Silicon Valley, because usually they are located where they are because that's where they are, not because of some other reason, is because, as Mohan said, there is critical mass of talent here. Your company, your startup, is absolutely dependent upon the quality of your team. You need the very best person in each role. You probably only have one person in that role, and they happen to be world class. Your ability to go find that person in another location is dramatically lower than your ability to find them here. Here you'll have multiple people to choose from, you interview them, and you select the best. If you have the passion for your mission, then that passion shines through and you attract them to your team. So it's absolutely essential to build a fantastic team, and there is no place on planet Earth that is better for that than Silicon Valley.
So Dave, to continue on that thread, where do you see this going, right? Because there is a huge housing crunch, your transportation time is like become 3x, it will become 4x in like a few years. How do you see Silicon Valley evolving?
I think there are significant problems in infrastructure. I would look to our government officials to figure out transportation. I think transportation is the government's purview, and we have to figure that out at the government level. Housing, on the other hand, is something that is supply and demand. And I don't know, I drive around the valley quite a lot, and there are massive amounts of new buildings being built for housing. So I think in fact, the data today suggests that that problem is starting to be solved. For the first time ever, housing prices did not rise, and they're flattening out for apartments. So in that, and there's still tons of capacity that's about to come online. So I believe on the housing front, we're gonna solve the problem through market forces. Transportation requires the government to help us.
So, not much to add. I think both of you are hitting on key reasons why this is a really magical place. I think the only thing I would have to add, I have 2 points to add. One is, it's definitely the talent here, but it's the diversity of the people here. I am a big believer in hiring people that aren't like me, that don't think like me, that don't have the you know, the same ideas I do, because I've learned over my career that it's a little painful to go through that sausage making process, but when you have that kind of diversity of thought, diversity of idea, you get to a way better outcome. And I really believe that's why, you know, you have these towns that are attracting, you know, as the startup mentality, but they're fairly uniform from a diverse perspective. I believe that our universities bring in a diverse set of talent. I believe the employers bring in a diverse set of talent, and that's really our secret sauce. Now, this is a very expensive place to live, and we may be limiting our ability to bring in the diversity because of that. So I think I would love to see better company and government partnerships, right? This idea of bringing in talent is not just a city issue, it's a Google issue, it's a Cisco issue, it's those sorts of companies. I get really worried that educators can't afford to live here. You know, we want to have great schools, not just universities, but K-12. So is there a way to do some sort of a partnership by which we have affordable housing for those professions that we need but that can't afford to stay here? So I would love to see more of a public-private partnership in solving some of the Bay Area problems. We don't lose magic that we have.
I totally agree with that.
So I'd like to address this in a completely different point of view and point of view from the young callers, you know, that are here. Should you ask your parents to move out of the Silicon Valley, or you know, should you ask them to pay for the high real estate prices and the high rents situation over here, and still continue to stay here, right? So what is a good idea? So while I see a lot of emerging startup ecosystems around the world, around all over the country, personally I feel the Silicon Valley is still the best for three factors that make it still the best. First and foremost, as a young entrepreneur or as an emerging entrepreneur, right? First and foremost, you're looking for creativity and ideas and passion, and you see that all around in every city or every community in and around Silicon Valley. So it's almost contagious. Coming up with ideas, coming up with passion, new way of doing things is almost contagious in Silicon Valley versus any other place, right? If so-and-so can be an entrepreneur, why can't I be an entrepreneur? If so-and-so has come up with a great idea, why can't I come up with a great idea? So that level of, a contagious, creative passion comes primarily this particular way, right? So that's one thing. The second is, in terms of actually, as young, school-going, children, emerging entrepreneurs, what you should be looking for is for role models. And Silicon Valley has enough role models all around you. You have Elon Musk, you have Zuckerberg, you have Larry Page, you have enough, emerging, growth companies, startups, and all over the place, as role models for you, right? So follow them, look at their life stories, learn about them. There's a CNBC title, there's this, in the TV show, which basically gives, about entrepreneurs and, their life history and biography, etc. Young school students, just follow that, learn about other people and that, etc. Silicon Valley has enough of them. And you can even meet these people all around you, in different, occasions, and that itself, is inspiring and fulfilling, right? The third is community. I mean, it's great to be in a community, of entrepreneurs,
forums where you can be part of it and ask your parents to go and, you know, take you over there, right? And that sort of an ecosystem, it's right here within probably the 50 mile radius compared to any other city out there, right? So to me, I think, you know, while it has a lot of this infrastructure and, you know, growing cars and other aspects, you know, that again, government officials, parents, everybody has to deal with, from a, you know, young student perspective, emerging entrepreneur perspective, leverage what you have all around you and, you know, absorb every bit of it. And you know, and this is the only place where you, all of these things, you know, the passion, the role models, you know, the community ecosystem, all of that comes together in one and only Silicon Valley.
I think Veena summed it up, you know, Silicon Valley is definitely a pressure cooker of innovation, you know, magic sort of happens because it's like an ecosystem, you know, our panelists were talking about an ecosystem, talents, innovation, that all comes together and just building out the most amazing products that the rest of the world is just like waiting for. I mean, look at Facebook, you know, I mean, it's just gone completely viral. Every country is, almost every country is using Facebook now. But these are products that have actually come out from Silicon Valley. And then role models, right? Because there are enough role models happening here. In fact, for me, that was a draw because we used to live out in Michigan and I could see the tremendous innovation happening out here. I said, I want to hang out with those guys. And I want to move here to Silicon Valley and rub shoulders with them and maybe I might become as smart as them. So that's the reason why I ended up moving here. But role models are absolutely key and I think, we have a phenomenal role model here, sitting on stage, with a track record of success. And so I would love to have one final question from our panelists here, which is, you know, what's your final words of wisdom? Because here are the coders, they are the future entrepreneurs of Silicon Valley that will launch companies that will turn millions and billions and trillion dollars. I mean, they are sitting right here in the audience, but what's that final message, Veena, we'll start with you, that you would like to leave with our young coders here?
First and foremost, you know, all the young coders, raise your hands. You guys are winners already. There are many kids, you know, sitting out there, sitting at home, you know, not participating in activities like this. You guys coming here and, you know, being part of, you know, Silicon Valley, you know, youth club, as well as being part of the technology forum, trying to understand where to go, you're already winners. You will go places. Keep it up, keep up the passion, and as I said, three things: passion, role models, community. Keep following those things, and you will be, you know, we would love to see you in the frontline news on CNN, on, you know, CNBC, everywhere, as, you know, successful entrepreneurs. Keep it going.
So I love those three things. I would just add, just don't ever give up. Just don't ever get up. It's gonna get tough at times. Whatever you do, don't ever give up.
A lot of you, as you get into your junior year and your senior year in high school, will be totally freaking out about college. Will my top college let me in? Will I get admittance to Stanford or Berkeley or what have you? I want to tell you that it doesn't matter. Yes, try to get into the best school that you can, but it doesn't matter. Ultimately, your career is going to be based upon what you do after college, after you come out. When I went to college, I got into MIT. I was so excited, it was my dream. My parents, however, my senior year in high school, got divorced, and all the money went out the window. I couldn't afford to go to MIT, so I went to the University of Missouri, a very normal, average school. I have been a CEO of multiple successful startups in Silicon Valley, and it's because of what I did after college. So that's my first comment to you. The second is, I want to expand upon the idea of role model. There have been studies done of what makes a person successful in their life, in their career. It's a twist on the role model. It's actually having a mentor. A mentor is not somebody that you look up to like, you know, Elon Musk. It's somebody that you interact with, that you ask questions of, that you learn from. Seek out in your career a mentor. Find somebody who will invest in you and help you advance as you move through your career, and that will pay dividends.
I think one thing I would like to add, in addition to all the role model, community, mentor, and other things, is as you know, as a young entrepreneur, I don't want to say that everything in life is full of roses. I think there will be challenges. You will face rejection. But I think when you come out, you know, how well you face this adversity is, you know, what makes you stronger, right? So for instance, you know, how do you make iron stronger? You know, how do you bend iron, right? You fire, right? When you make it hot, then you can bend it. So likewise, you will go through this process in life, and you know, with every success and every failure, quote unquote failure, there's lessons to be learned. So never give up and keep at it.
So wonderful final words of wisdom. I would love to give one action item to each of our young coders here. They are all a little bit tensed up, I can tell. They are like ready to do their pitch, and the tension level is rising with every minute. They are sitting there quietly, but I can tell. I can read minds. But there's one thing that, an action item for each of you. You know, we had a young entrepreneur panel. Please connect with them on LinkedIn. You know, connect with them and find out what they are doing. Follow them a little bit, because you will see that they were a student just like you. They ended up in a good school and they went through a career. Now they're working for PayPal, for YouTube, and NerdWallet. And their careers will blossom over time. And you will find that they are phenomenally successful. And all of you are destined for that route as well. Just connect with them on LinkedIn, figure out what they are doing, and perhaps there will be some learning from you. But I'm pretty excited about this pitch fest that will happen. So nobody leave. That's the next segment. And we would love to have all of you please give a big round of applause to our amazing panelists today. And thank you all for spending your Saturday afternoon really appreciate that. And Mohan, I will play the game of juggling the mind here. Okay. Thank you so much. Veena, Sherry. And Dave and Mohan. Thank you so much. Shivam is going to invite our judges, and I wonder if it's possible for us to leave some of the chairs in the first row for our judges, because we have about 6 or 8 judges. So Shivam, here, let's honor them.
Fifth, Latch and Patch. Sixth, Optimus.
7th SAC pack, and there should be 18. Is there any team who hasn't sent me their deck yet that is here today? Oh, and you guys will be going last. Okay. So you guys will be going last. So if I can get Team Aqua to get ready on site here for the competition. So main rules for the pitch class will be each team has 5 minutes, a hard stop of 5 minutes for their presentation. If they if you guys finish your presentation early, there'll be time for Q&A, but Q&A is if you have 5 minutes for your entire presentation, there'll be no Q&A.
goal is to help struggling middle school students solve their math homework using helpful videos, hints, and more.
The problem. Many middle school students struggle with their math homework to the point where they just give up on school entirely. This could affect their future and eventually our economy. A study from EdgingEatReport.org says that 37% of parents struggle with math homework, while 49% of moms specifically struggle with it. Here we have a survey from
to the left on both screens, which lets you access the home page, your your account settings and the math tab. To the right side, it shows what the math layout would look like, where it has where the chatbot would be, where you have you put your problem in, it gives an explanation, and then there's a similar problem, link for a video, a click for a hint. And now we'll move on to the prototype portion.
So in our demo, we created a mini chatbot, which does simple operations like addition, multiplication, division, and subtraction. And we'll give a brief overview before we do a live demonstration. So we use two platforms for this. We use Dialogflow and Heroku. So Dialogflow is like a front-end platform. It takes the user input, understands it, and sends the information back to the backend code. So Heroku runs the backend code in Python, and it does all the calculations for us. And then it gives the output to Dialogflow, which then displays it to the user. So now I'll give a live demonstration. So this is for addition. So we did 56 plus 56, and our response was 112. So this is multiplication. And this is division, and as you see, it gives a decimal response.
Security team, smart doctor on the side to get ready. Thank you.
with Leslie and Mo, and we would like to show you a really small video.
Thank you.
please put your name down on the judging sheet? And we noticed that we left out one of the criteria that wasn't marked earlier. So we'll find you, but please try to mark every single, there are 10 criteria, please mark them all, rate them all. And if you can put your name down also on top, that would be super helpful.
Mommy, my ear hurts!
So before this,
a healthier form to our website. And I would keep it handy for the future if I was prepared. Then, yeah, she comes up to me one night complaining of ear pain and is very fussy. So I log into the Healthier app to check if she has an ear infection. I then take a video for it.
This video is then sent to our image intelligence software via the Smart Doctor app. It is then analyzed by being compared to several image banks of healthy and infected ears, which it uses for reference. The results of the transaction are displayed in just a few seconds.
Oh no, she has an ear infection, but now I have all the information I need to get her the proper medical attention. And now I'm confident that I'm not wasting time or money at the doctor, and she's not going to be exposed to any diseases when if I took her to the ER.
With ear infections being among the top 10 reasons to visit the ER, we believe this presents us with an enormous opportunity to serve parents. The telemedicine market currently stands at $20 billion, but is projected to grow up to $62 billion in the next 5 years. A number of favorable things like insurance coverage cutbacks, technology, and consumer demands are converging to make this happen. For starters, we will target select cities that either are suffering from a shortage of doctors or have an environment where ear infections are very common. We will start as a pilot program by dispersing our product to doctors so they can spread the idea of our product around to people who may need it. We will have listings on Amazon, and we will also have our own e-commerce website. We will advertise on Facebook and Amazon.
Our product is $27 plus one free scan. There is then a subscription fee of $80 that gives you unlimited scans for 6 months. Our pricing is designed to compete with our substitutes and be less than the price of an ER visit. Our competition includes a group of self-diagnostic products that require the patient to analyze themselves. If the patient does not have medical training, this is a very bad option and is very inaccurate. Next, there are products that perform remote checkups with a telemedicine doctor. These, you're still paying for wasted appointments, and our product succeeds because our image intelligence guides the patient's decisions. It is more accurate, less expensive, and an appointment is only made when there's an absolute need for one. The subscription is very healthy, it has a very healthy margin.
Our subscription plan is a very healthy margin, so you'll be profitable in the next 2 years. We are hoping for an investment partner that can help us with our initial capital costs.
We have a great team. We hope to work with you in the future too to make a major impact on the world. Thank you. Use Healthier and you'll be healthier.
Design and computer science led me to create this idea. I'm Madeline. I'm a freshman at Foothill High School, and I'm interested in marketing and presentation. I participated in speech and debate.
So, Sumplify is a mobile phone application that essentially turns your phone into a microphone.
So, what's the problem, and what inspired us to create this product? First of all, the inconvenience of using physical microphones, like the wires here, inspired us. So, they're physical, they're often bulky, they're hard to transport, and sometimes they glitch a lot. Our mission is to eliminate all the problems above by integrating Sumplify into presentation settings, especially into classrooms. So what's the solution? The solution is a mobile application that allows your phone to connect remotely to an external speaker via Bluetooth. Basically, what this does is it transforms your phone into a microphone. Our end goal is to have a chip implanted into the phone so that no external speaker will be needed. And this idea was inspired by our peers and classmates. So how does Sumplify work? Sumplify is basically a microphone minus the hassle. So it works similarly. We would speak in like this, and then the sound would come out of an external speaker. However, there wouldn't be any wires involved since it would be with a Bluetooth speaker. And additionally, you wouldn't have to worry about transporting the microphone since a phone is with you wherever you go.
So revenue will be generated for our app with in-app ads, and you'll be also be able to purchase a premium membership, which is a one-time fee, and this will eliminate all ads in the app and give you additional access to the other features.
Okay, so what are we going to use to help launch our product? We're going to focus on digital advertisements since in this day and age, we're advancing towards more technology-based products. We're going to strategically place ads in front of YouTube videos on Instagram, Facebook, and social media sites where we can reach a broad range of consumers. We're going to partner with people and have sponsors, and we're also going to establish a strong online presence by interacting with our consumers through an email list. Our target market is the mobile app market, which was valued at $70 billion in 2015.
So here we have competitor analysis. As you can see, Sumplify is the only one out of all four of these that has no wires or cords, it has mobile connectivity, and it also has Bluetooth connectivity. So this is, who's our target customers? So our target customer is any consumer who needs to amplify their voice, but they do not have, or they do not want to use a real physical microphone.
So why does Sumplify matter to our consumers? Well, basically, using Sumplify will save time and save hassle, and it actually helps the customer save money. Instead of having to buy a physical microphone, use maintenance fees and such, you can just download an app and it can do the same thing as a microphone. Additionally, I know you guys are probably thinking, okay, a microphone does this, but what about a wireless microphone? The difference is that with Sumplify, you don't have to carry any microphone at all. You can just carry your phone.
So here's our financial analysis. Our cash flow by the fourth year will be roughly $40,000. And our cost of goods sold and research and development are both $0 because we're not actually spending money on researching and developing because we're developing the app ourselves. Here's a graph of our financial credit projections. And here is a wireframe of what we have created so far. As you can see, the first screen is a description of Sumplify, and then the second screen allows you to connect or pair yourself to one of the Bluetooth speakers. And then you will be able to adjust the microphone sensitivity, the volume of the speaker, and you will be also able to turn on and off the speaker.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So I kind of Team Optimus to the side here, ready for the presentation, and now we'll have Team Clash with Hatch.
So our company is called Latch & Patch, and we develop a bike tool for cyclists. So our company consists of Patrick, I'm the CEO. He's our CFO, and we got Rohit, our CMO.
Okay, so our product is a small handheld tool that allows you to fix flat tires quickly and efficiently. So our mission is to solve a persisting problem in the cycling community. That problem being unprepared for flat tires and not knowing how to fix them.
So we came up with the idea by first looking at all of our common interests, and we all are avid bikers, we bike pretty often, and we've all faced the problem of having a flat tire. So we just decided we should develop a tool that fixes this problem, allowing anybody to patch a punctured inner tube without even having to remove their tire or the wheel.
Latch & Patch will succeed because it's currently the only of its kind on the market, and we have limited competitors, which include companies that sell standard bike patch kits and the distributors that distribute these products. Our target consumers are people who avidly bike and are looking for a much faster and cleaner way to patch up their bike. So we made a survey and distributed it, asking people how many times have they gotten a flat tire, and did they have the tools necessary to fix these. And what we found is most people said they had to take their bike to a repair shop to get it fixed, and 88.2% of people said they would be interested in our tool.
So this is our marketing plan. So we would like to advertise on Facebook, YouTube, and Google. And we'd like to sell our product on Amazon. We have our own website, which we are selling our product on, and using Google search engine so that our product is available to those who are interested in it and are most likely to purchase it. And we're also going to put them in retail stores.
So for our financials, we said by the end of our fourth year, our gross profit will be $782,000, and our total operating expenses will be about $700,000.
So we're going to have a profit of over $200,000 after 4 years of having a product on the market. Alright, so we have a website, but now we're going to do our demo.
You can replace these. We also sell our pump and on the very left our tool. When we sell
We sell to consumers for only $17.50, and we sell to our bike distributors for only $12.50,
which is much cheaper than taking it to a bike repair shop or any of the other methods out there, such as replacing your vehicle.
Yeah, so our product is convenient, it's easy to use, anyone can use it. All you need is this one tool. It's cheap, affordable, quick, and if you're stuck on the side of the road with a punctured tire, you'll be able to get up rolling to your home within a matter of 1 minute.
Thank you.
So can Team Sackpack come to the side, ready for the presentation, and I'll have Team Optimus. And here's a little tip for each of the teams presenting. Pull the microphone close to your mouth because some folks are speaking and nobody can hear them. And that's, put in like months and months of effort and that is not going to be put to use today if you're not going to speak loud and clear. Communication is the most important criteria for a successful startup. So put the microphone close to your mouthpiece and talk. Thanks.
Hi, our company is Optimus. Our product is a smart bike lock. So I'm Sanjana Mishra, I'm the CEO. I'm currently a senior at Los Altos High.
I'm Mihir Mishra, I'm a ninth grader at Los Altos High. And our third missing member is Arya, and he also is a ninth grader at Los Altos High.
So I think all of us understand that bike theft and tire theft is an issue in our community. So there are two options. You can either overlock your bike, if that's a thing, as shown in this picture. Or, you can go a more non-traditional way and try something a little bit more dangerous. Our product aims to eliminate both of these issues. We aim to provide a smart bike lock, a bike lock that will provide easy access to your bike without, going through all the hassles.
So every year, 1.5 million bikes are stolen, which means by the end of this presentation, 15 bikes will be stolen.
So we decided to see. We know it's a problem, but does it affect our community, specifically? So after our survey results, we found out that yes, a lot of people do find this to be an issue. So we thought, why not address this issue in a more specific, targeted way?
So this is an example. This is the prototype that we've made. And that's some more pictures of the prototype from different angles.
So now we're going to show a short video demo of what it would look like in real life to use our product, the Optimus Lock. So the video right now, I can explain what happens in the video. So essentially, I have my bike and I lock it to the thing I want to secure it to using the Optimus Lock.
So you attach it to the spokes on your wheel and you pull it out from here and here, and you can attach the two cords together in order to secure your bike to whatever you're trying to secure it, as well as secure your wheel and your frame. Then a thief tries to come and steal the bike, is unable to because we use a strong, it's a material called kryptonite that's unplayed, you can't burn it and you can't cut it. So that's what happens in the video to explain
what happens with our product.
So some of the features that we have in the bike lock is the remote access, the fingerprinting, the GPS tracking system, the alarm system, and also it's a flexible cord so you can adjust it easily. So what's special about our bike lock is that you can buy different levels of security. So the base price is $55, and that's for the remote access only. And then as you spend more money, then you can get different features that would make your bike lock more safe.
And so this is the app demo. So you click on the Optimus app. So after creating a new account, you have access to specific features that you've purchased with the purchase of Optimus Lock. And the most basic thing that we offer is the remote access, so you can remotely lock or unlock your bike. And this is extremely helpful, especially for families that share bikes. So instead of having to, you know, buy multiple bikes, you can just have this one lock, and if different members of the family do have access to this, to the online bike lock, they're able to share this bike.
So some of the target cities are like the major cities in the U.S. because they have a lot of bikes normally. So there's like Los Angeles, Seattle, Washington, D.C., and other major cities with a lot of bikes.
So our plan is to initially target just the United States. We understand that the United States is a growing bike market, and we wanted to tap into that as early as we could.
So this is a graph of like the cost and safety of many locks. As you can see, Optimus is more on the safe side, and also it's cheaper than most bike locks.
So the market size. So there are around 70 million bikes within the United States alone, so that's a $14 billion market right there. And as we said, 1.5 million bikes are stolen every year. In order to prevent that, it's much cheaper to just buy a $50 bike lock than, you know, buy a whole new bike. So where you can purchase these, online bike stores, Amazon, retail stores as well. We're trying to roll out this product as soon as possible.
So as I said before, there's the $55 base price, and then as you buy more features, the cost gets more expensive.
So we're going to be a C-Corp, a limited distribution, and also, less profits.
So this is a work in progress, so we understand that we still might be editing our prototype and growing. Thank you for listening to our presentation.
Introducing the patent-pending SAT Pack. That pack's designed for today, prepared for tomorrow. I'm Logan Dickey, the CEO and founder of the company.
My name is Ames Ruggi, I'm the CIO.
And I'm Shreya Vishishta, the CMO, and I'm directly responsible for the brand outreach. So what is SAT Pack? SAT Pack is the one and only revolutionary new backpack, which is fireproof, bulletproof, and water-resistant, which uses Kevlar-strength materials to resist specifically against caliber bullets.
Capitalizing on the safety market, primarily with that on and around school grounds, the SAT-Pack offers a solution to the industry without the downsides that the competition possesses.
The backpack industry is a $2.7 billion industry in the United States alone, and even farther, and even larger abroad. That's why we're searching for $150,000 in capital that we can fund our company and return $450,000 in revenue within the following year, per year increasing at an exponential rate.
So what's the problem? Alternatives to the SAT Pack either feature one-time uses or largely expensive items that don't offer the same kind of protection and additional features. Also, backpacks are very limited organization-wise, and backpacks wear out very easily over time and have to be replenished every few years. Also, security is a big issue too. As you can see by this chart here, each year the individuals impacted by crime is going up. And just in the past 5 years alone, crime rate has increased by 18%.
The SAT Pack uses Kevlar and carbon fiber strength materials in order to provide unparalleled protection compared to our competitors. In fact, theoretical testing shows that the SAT Pack will be able to resist multiple impact wounds from an AR, specifically that of an AR-15, which is a very common weapon used. Organization features such as built-in accordion binder into the backpack provides optional organization for quick and easy storage, as 56% of high school students state that organization is one of their top concerns. Furthermore, an optional 20,000 mAh power bank is integrated into the design for peace of mind. In the back of the design, where 80% of the protection is stored, you can encrypt a GPS tracking device for parents and law enforcement to keep track of their kids in case something arises. In fact, you can also find the backpack if it's lost or stolen.
So what really makes this product unique? So SAT Pack contains many specially designed features which are ultimately like the bare-bone model of this backpack. And it also has an encrypted GPS tracking system, which assists in law enforcement and parents to be in a peace state of mind to help track their kids. And it's also designed for students, and it is affordable and maintains the similar price point like a normal backpack, even though it has many of these design features.
So now what we want to do is we want to sell products to both parents and kids, and we want to make the market much better. So what we want to do is, the market is undersaturated right now, and those who do it just don't do it well. And so consumers are at a large risk because they don't have access to technology like this. And we want to provide an access, a way for consumers to get access to this technology and save themselves. Now, price point analysis estimates that the product will cost around $15 to produce, absolutely out of additional features, such as the power bank. However, it will include the GPS tracking. Now, for sales directly from Zacpack, we want to mark it up by about 90 to 110%, which is 190 to 210% overall of the initial price. And we want to sell it directly on our website.
So here are the listed marketing strategies listed out over here. So the first is internet. We'll be using social media and online stores such as Amazon, currently known to be one of the retail giants. And transactional marketing, which is big box retailers such as Target and Walmart, and they often host promotional events to get their consumers interested. And next is direct, which sends potential customers information about the product, usually using via email. And there's also speaking events, which host events and create publicity regarding the product and how it is used, often using demos.
So competition. There are six big companies that produce backpacks, such as JanSport, Herschel, and some others. And this being said, there are two conglomerates that own most of these. And with that, only one of these companies produces true bulletproof backpacks, but they're marketed towards military personnel and feature a 50-pound ceramic plate that has a one-time use. This is not marketed towards school children. Now, the Zacpack uses new technology, which is revolutionary and marketed towards students. Furthermore, the other technology used in other backpacks is outdated and inefficient, unlike the Zacpack, so we are giving a new revolutionary light to this market and saving people.
Okay, and here's some for our finances. So again, the base model will cost about $58 to produce, and with an estimate of about one.
What?
Time's up.
Okay.
So it costs $58 to produce, and with a markup of about 172%, we will be selling these for about $110. But this will go down within the first bulk purchases of the company. And with this profit margin, within the first year alone, we will have all toxic access. All toxic assets liquidated.
Okay, so at nearly 1% of the entire industry, we can expect to gross $27 million in sales, and this will increase at an exponential rate to a theoretical limit of about 10% of the industry has been achieved, in which case we will profit about $270 million in sales per year. And so the first 2 quarters of the company, we can expect a negative cash flow of around $58,000 until we sell the initial units. This being said, once we do so, we will have a net profit of about $52,000, which will furthermore increase to our expected revenue of about $450,000 per year until we can reach this estimated 10% of the entire market share. In the life of the typical student, the student deals with media, peer dynamics, school, and more, making it quite the emotional load to cope with. This situation is also true and more amplified for adults. In truth, we are all trying to cope, not just students or people with problems. We sent out a survey and found that 25% to 30% of students clearly need help, and that an additional 66% could use help. So what is the solution? Imagine an intelligent app that feels like a trusted friend and supportive assistant and provides emotional and logistical support. Introducing Smooth. Smooth is an ML and AI-based virtual assistant app that learns about the user from a variety of data sources and maintains well-being in its users. Smooth evolves into Smooth Platform, which will allow developers to craft empathetic experiences. For example, Spotify could integrate this by choosing tracks for its users based on their mood without any user input. Smooth Suggestions Engine, a core aspect of how Smooth works, takes data from a variety of sources and uses a machine learning model to generate logistical and well-being recommendations based on fundamental teachings of yoga, mindfulness, and neuroscience. Smooth operates in three modes: proactive, reactive, and regular routines. You'll see more about this in the demo. We'll now move on to our demo just to give you a better understanding of how Smooth works. So I'd like you all to meet Joe, a fictional character who will tell this demo through the eyes and feelings of. It's currently the morning of Joe's swimmeet, and he needs to be at his swimmeet in 1 hour. Joe is currently waking up. Smooth, knowing that Joe's waking up, prompts him to start his personalized morning routine to help him start his day right. Joe starts his morning routine, and Smooth walks him through a mindfulness breathing sequence to help him start his day right by getting him calm and focused. It is now 30 minutes later and 30 minutes before Joe's swimmeet. Smooth, knowing that Joe's swimmeet starts in 30 minutes, prompts him to start getting ready to get there on time and in a relaxed manner, therefore helping him avoid stress. On opening the notification, Joe is presented with a checklist of items which he can use to pack for his swimmeet. Smooth has intelligently allocated enough time for Joe to get ready and get there on time, all the while helping Joe avoid stress. It's now an hour later, and Joe has completed warm-ups at his swimmeet. But he's feeling anxious due to his self-induced pressure to perform. Smooth suggests Joe to take a minute to calm down. Smooth is very diverse with its solution set. It's not just using mindfulness or neuroscience. So in this case, Smooth asks Joe to visualize success and walks him through some power poses. This differentiates ourselves from our competitors who are doing this nearly the same thing, but only using mindfulness and diagnostics through a chatbot. And this is our competition. We're mostly competing with Headspace, Calm, and Wisa, all of whom has secured reasonable funding. However, we differentiate ourselves from our competitors by building a unique, complete, and patentable solution. For marketing, we plan to market to parents, schools, and enterprises, all of whom care about wellness due to various reasons. We will use targeted marketing and explicitly designed for viral adoption. We'll sell through the Android and iOS app stores. We're using a subscription-based revenue model at $1 a month per user. Our adoption doubles every year with 1 in every 10,000 English-speaking smartphone users globally. Those are our market segment and customers. Our financial model reflects both students and adults as our target. We spend $100 to acquire a customer in year one. We spend $50 on the existing customer to get a new one in year two. Basically, we have spending per customer each year and double the customer base. This reflects 625 million global English-speaking smartphone users who we target. Based on the customer acquisition model that you saw, we get to an operating profit by year 4
8 out of every 10,000 people is a user. This is the team. We used to have 3 other people, but they were unavailable due to several reasons. In short, we're a company that improves its users' lives using technology. We're in the fitness mind-body market, which is valued at approximately $542 billion. And would like $20 million to build an app that will become cash flow positive in 1 million. And in 4 years, I mean, it'll be cash flow positive at $1 million in 4 years and generate $39 million in revenue in year 6.
So now I'll invite our top 3 teams to the stage. So in no specific order, could I get Team Lash and Patch, Team Optimus, and Team Smart Talk? Give them a big round of applause. So yeah, before I get to that, So actually, our second place team was a team that won the Booth Prize. Before I get to second place, I'll announce the first place winner. And our first place winner was Team Smart Doctor. Awesome. Congratulations to our second place team, Team Lashbox. Another round of applause for them.
Okay, congratulations to all the parents, all the coaches, very nicely done. And I'm really, truly appreciative of the judges to take the time to be here. So we can stay here as long as you want, take pictures. And I'd love to get your help if we can put the room back the way it was before you leave. We would really appreciate that. We just need to stack up the chairs and put the tables back. So thank you all, thank you.
Yeah. spend a few dollars, I'm buying the basketball skin in Fortnite. Let's go, boys.
Stage exit. It even talks about the outlet. One down day one. Yes, one chair on one side and two on the other. I used to get it every Tuesday and then I get it. Jim, the multi-purpose room isn't right.
Okay, so let me tell them before.
Sure. Yeah, you don't want to lose them.
Yeah.